Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Yoga Nidra, The Art of Transformational Sleep by Kamini Desai, PhD, narrated by Siiri Scott. This book is dedicated to my beloved father and mother, whose love I have come to cherish deeply, my deepest gratitude for all I have learned from you both. Your teachings have contributed to the lives of thousands of people the world over and live on through this book. It is my hope to make such a contribution to humanity. Foreword. The year was 1972. It was near the beginning of my career as a clinical psychologist, and I was working at a hospital-based clinic. The patient was 13 years old and pregnant for the second time while her maternal grandmother raised her 2-year-old child. Her mother was a heroin addict. She did not know her own father. She was depressed, anxious, and the only thing she looked forward to was the birth of this child. I believed my job was to get her to stop having babies while still a child herself. But she wanted this baby so somebody would love her and it would make her important. She had insight. She knew what she was doing and why she was doing it. This was the first time I clearly saw the limits of psychological insight. Mere insight would not change this girl's lifestyle, nor has it been enough for thousands of patients who have followed. Last year, in a social setting, I met a 45-year-old Iraq War veteran. He said he was suffering from traumatic brain injury, TBI, and post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD. He reported that he was being treated as an outpatient at a VA hospital and was taking 15 different powerful psychiatric medications to control his numerous symptoms. He was also receiving counseling. I subsequently learned that he committed suicide and joined the ranks of the 23 U.S. veterans who kill themselves each day. Different assumptions have underscored the major approaches to psychotherapy, personal change, and growth. Psychoanalysis and its many offshoots are based on the assumption that once the historical antecedents are learned, the patient will understand why they are the way they are and will be relieved of their troubling symptoms. This is referred to as insight. Behavior therapy and its derivations assume that changing behavior patterns through learning will result in alleviation of maladaptive behaviors. Cognitive therapy is based on the belief that by identifying and changing negative, self-defeating thoughts, one will become symptom-free. These and most other psychotherapeutic techniques either ignore or give nodding recognition to the importance of the physiological processes in the individual. On the other hand, Yoga Nidra directly addresses, focuses on, and changes habitual physiological reactive patterns. This results in actual change, healing, growth, and freedom without the need to go into the story. In my 45 years of clinical work with every type of psychological or psychiatric problem at the front lines of mental health struggles, I have encountered psychotics, schizophrenics, bipolars, the depressed, traumatized, addicted, neurotic, and the worried well. I have treated children, adolescents, adults, and the mature in individual, couples, family, and group settings. I have forensically evaluated those accused of murder, white collar, and street crime. Although I am not a psychiatrist and do not prescribe psychiatric medication, I have observed their ample use in treatment throughout my career. I have studied various approaches to psychotherapy and human change, ranging from classical Freudian psychoanalysis to past lives regression therapy and everything in between. For at least the past 30 years, I have been impressed with the value of meditation and body-oriented approaches to therapy, including massage, yoga, and tai chi. Then, last summer, my wife kidnapped and dragged me to an ashram hidden deep in the Ocala National Forest in Florida to learn Yoga Nidra meditation from a renowned master and his daughter. I was blown away. The benefits of meditation are well documented in a wealth of respected scientific literature. I have urged many of my patients to develop a meditation practice and often teach them deep breathing exercises, especially for treating symptoms of anxiety. While a serious and effective meditation practice is difficult to develop and maintain, Yoga Nidra is as easy as, but much more effective than, the breathing techniques I formerly taught. Yogi Amrit Desai perfected the ancient technique of Yoga Nidra to its current level of sophistication. His daughter went on to receive a doctorate in psychology and created a groundbreaking curriculum based on his teachings. In this book, she integrates her traditional academic learning with Yoga Nidra for a useful guide to the modern applications of this ancient practice. Traditional meditation requires considerable effort to empty the mind. Many individuals believe they are incapable of meditation or sitting still. Quieting the mind in that way is difficult because it is antithetical to the actual normal functioning of the brain, which is always seeking answers, solving problems, and protecting us from the outside world. Yoga Nidra meditation is easy because it is based on something that the body already knows how to do. Go to sleep. Through an ancient and well-designed process, the mind is guided through stages of sleep while the recipient is awake and fully conscious. The process results in the same brainwave changes that occur during deep sleep, although you are aware and awake. It can create the deepest level of meditation achieved by well-practiced yogis. In this state, various beneficial changes occur. The consequences of stress are reversed, blood pressure and cortisol levels drop, heart rate slows, and the body begins a process of rejuvenation and healing. The beneficial consequences of entering this state on a regular basis are that the unpleasant symptoms of insomnia, anxiety, depression, addiction, and PTSD are reduced. For example, addicts use the substance to which they are addicted to reduce stress in their lives, including the stress created by the need for more of the substance itself. Removing the addictive substance leaves the individual without the coping mechanism needed to deal with the normal stressors of life. Yoga Nidra both reduces the severity of life's stressors as well as providing a tool upon which the addict can deliberately rely when confronted with the inevitable complications of life. In this book, Dr. Desai explains how Yoga Nidra can be applied to every aspect of human life. This book not only explains the process, why it works, and what it treats, it also gives an invaluable bonus at the end, exact instructions on how to practice Yoga Nidra, and a complete copy of a Yoga Nidra script. So, you can use it for yourself or those you love, and, If you're in the mental health business, you can also use it in your clinical work. I conduct Yoga Nidra sessions on a regular basis for my patients and others who don't want to discuss their story, but nevertheless want relief from the stressors of life. I strongly recommend it. Frederick L. Coven, PhD, licensed psychologist, New York and Florida. Clinical coordinator of the adolescent unit, Harlem Hospital, New York, New York, 1972 to 1980. Chief psychologist of Bellevue Hospital, New York, New York, 1980 to 1994. Author of Crazy All the Time, Life, Lessons, and Insanity on the Psych Ward of Bellevue Hospital, Simon & Schuster, 1994. Clinical faculty of the graduate schools of New York University, Pace University, Fordham University, Yeshiva University, and St. John's University, New York, New York, 1972 to 1994. Currently in private practice in Key West, Florida, and clinical supervisor, U.S. Navy Alcohol and Substance Abuse Program. Introduction. Yoga Nidra, the art of non-doing. Yoga Nidra is one of the least known and most underappreciated practices of yoga, yet its potential reach is immense. In our modern society, many of us are accustomed to doing more to get more. Even when we want to relax, we ask, "How do I do that?" Relaxation doesn't happen by doing more, yet this is how most of us go about it. Yoga Nidra is not about doing more. It is about doing less. Yoga Nidra is about releasing the struggling and striving to get somewhere. It is the art and practice of doing nothing to arrive exactly where you want to be. It is like floating. Floating is not something you do. It is something that happens in the absence of doing. It is an experience of being held, being carried, but it can only happen when you stop struggling to keep yourself upright. Stop doing, and floating happens. Stop efforting, and sleep happens. When you let go of any doing, everything gets done. This concept is so foreign to the Western mind, we can hardly fathom it. There is a reason stress is at epidemic levels in the West, and I believe this is why. We don't know how to stop. Our waking hours have taken over our sleeping hours. Even our sleep and rest is in service of doing more rather than being more. We don't sleep to be rested, to revitalize and nourish ourselves. We sleep so we can get up and do more the next day. We haven't mastered the art of non-doing along with the art of doing. We haven't learned how to relax in action. What if there was a way we could experience being carried away by the waters of life? A way to feel held and supported in the midst of life, rather than struggling to keep our head above water? That is exactly what Yoga Nidra is designed to do. Through the practice of Yoga Nidra, you learn to relax as deeply as in sleep while awake. Yoga Nidra is an age-old practice of yoga, described in the ancient texts. It is not new. It is composed of a series of breath, body, and awareness techniques designed to help you move into progressive states of relaxation, of non-doing. Though it is impossible to achieve relaxation with greater effort, you can enter a non-doing state where you are doing nothing and relaxation happens. The techniques of Yoga Nidra are active techniques that allow access to the non-doing state of being. The function of the technique is to do in such a way that you slip into a state of non-doing, so much so that the experience of the body and mind can disappear completely for a time. The result is a highly regenerative state where the energy normally burned by the mind is fully freed to heal and restore the body. This healing energy of the body, freed from the mind, can also become a spiritual force, unlocking inner guidance, knowing, and insight into your true nature. Yogis state that 45 minutes of yoga nidra is as restorative as 3 hours of sleep. The body needs to let go. It needs to rest. It needs to have profound experiences of non-doing so it can regenerate itself. Without this, the body begins to tire. Like a car, it needs maintenance and repair. Keep it in overdrive, and it will eventually burn out. Yoga Nidra is regenerative, but it is more than a nap. It is a spiritual practice that, through a structured and conscious movement through sleep states, takes you to realms beyond the mind and into the fourth state of consciousness, beyond waking, dreaming, and deep sleep. Ancient yogis knew that a vital, rested, and restored body is a necessary first step toward inner awakening. Yoga Nidra is a practice that can be used at many different levels, all of which serve our ultimate potentials as human beings and as evolving souls. It is up to us to determine how far we want to take the practice and for what purpose. Its beauty is that it addresses the entire spectrum, from the concrete to the most subtle. What are the benefits of Yoga Nidra? Most people believe that change can only happen in the realm of doing, and that achieving and doing more is the only means to changing one's life. Yet, doing can only take place in the waking state. Change in any other state of consciousness can only be accessed through non-doing. Non-doing gives access to change in conscious dream states, deep sleep, and in the fourth state, beyond waking, dreaming, and deep sleep. In Yoga Nidra, you are accessing aspects of yourself where your active doing has no access. Its effects are created from beyond the mind rather than through the mind. Here are some of the benefits of Yoga Nidra that appear from beyond the reach of the logical, analytical, and rational doing mind. Relaxation, restoration, physical health, and stress management. Starting at the foundational level, Yoga Nidra brings you to deep states of non-doing that help you sleep better, neutralize excess stress, and restore profound peace, relaxation, and rejuvenation to the body. Yoga Nidra takes you to brainwave states where the organs and systems of the body are nourished and regenerated. Yoga Nidra slows the rate at which you age and keeps you looking younger, longer. The body is its own healer. It knows how to heal itself. However, it needs the right environment to do so. This is what doctors and surgeons do. They don't heal a person. They give the body the best possible environment to heal itself. This is why doctors can never guarantee an outcome. It is all up to the body. What if you could influence your body's capacity to heal itself? In this book, I will show you how Yoga Nidra can free the healing potential of the body to do just that. You will hear how Yoga Nidra can be used as an adjunct practice to any mainstream treatment for health or recovery from illness. I will be surveying numerous studies which show how restoring optimal balance to the body can aid in the prevention and healing of such disparate health challenges as infertility, digestive issues, insomnia, allergies, skin conditions, heart conditions, and autoimmune diseases. Healthy relationship to thoughts. Stressful thought patterns influence our health and quality of life. Yoga Nidra allows us to relate differently to our thoughts and redirect the thought patterns of worry, anxiety, and fear that affect our ability to enjoy life, our loved ones, and ultimately our health. At an even deeper level, the practice allows us to create a different relationship to limiting perceptions, beliefs, and core programming that unconsciously drive our lives. Consider that we are not tired only because we work hard. We are also tired because of what the mind does. The more we can manage what the mind does, the more energy we will have to live our life. Detoxification and integration of incomplete experiences. Yoga Nidra allows us to resolve and release incomplete, unprocessed emotions and experiences that came but never left. Sometimes we hold on to overwhelming events that we can't process and we shut down. As a result, these experiences remain stuck and never fully move through us. Yoga Nidra takes us into deep states where we can let go of them. The breaks that normally hold these unfinished experiences in place are lifted, and we begin to rid ourselves of the undigested past. The experiences leave without us ever having to know what they were or where they came from. All we have to do is breathe, relax, and let it happen. Experiencing one's true nature. Ultimately, all these benefits of Yoga Nidra prepare us for its ultimate purpose: experiencing our true nature, our essence, both kinesthetically and experientially. We may intellectually know that we are more than our mind and body, but how do we experience our essence? It is one thing to say, "I am more than mind and body." It is another to actually know our essence with every fiber of our being. Understanding is only half the solution. Understanding is the map, but the map alone is not enough. We must travel the path as well. Many people may superbly describe the map. They may even write scholarly books. But if they haven't traveled the path itself, the map is ultimately of little use. Combining knowledge with real-life experience is the key. The beauty of Yoga Nidra practice is that it can serve as a laboratory within which to practice the knowledge. Here, the teachings come alive. We have a chance not just to know them intellectually, but to experience how they work through our own body and mind. This merging of understanding, enhanced and deepened through personal practice, is a potent combination. The teachings are no longer something to think about. They become something we may embody and become. The six tools of Yoga Nidra. In this book, we will explore each of the six tools of Yoga Nidra. These will allow us to optimally attain the benefits we have discussed. The tools are 1. Realization. 2. Integration. 3. disidentification, 4, intention, 5, relaxation, 6, restoration. The first tool, realization, works with the big picture, the ultimate purpose of Yoga Nidra. The remaining tools speak to the practical, day-to-day benefits to be gained from a Yoga Nidra practice. Most people just want to feel better. They want to be able to sleep, have less stress, and manage their unhelpful habits. Yoga Nidra addresses all of this, whether an individual is interested in self-realization or not. The tools of integration, disidentification, intention, relaxation, and restoration allow each person to gain a degree of life mastery. Life mastery grants more peace, more happiness, greater health, and self-management. These results can be an end in and of themselves, or they can be a stepping stone to the ultimate tool of realization. The more quiet and peaceful the mind is, and the healthier the body is, the more likely we are to notice that which is beyond it. The body-mind suffers from identification with limiting patterns, known as samskaras, the internal aspect of karma. This internal aspect of karma is made up of thoughts, feelings, experiences, and conclusions about our past that we adopted as true. These incomplete experiences and beliefs affect all levels of body and mind. They affect the way we think, feel, and act. They affect the choices we make. If not properly managed, identification with internal karma can create undesirable limiting effects. The tools of Yoga Nidra are designed to help you manage, transcend, and neutralize the effects of these limiting patterns. How this book is arranged. This book is divided into three sections. The first section introduces you to the philosophy of Yoga Nidra using the six tools of Yoga Nidra as a foundation for understanding. The second section applies the ancient philosophy of Yoga Nidra to modern maladies, including stress, addiction, depression, and anxiety. The last section of the book includes suggestions for practice, how to set up for Yoga Nidra, and a Yoga Nidra script. This book is not just about Yoga Nidra. It is a handbook for your life. Step by step, it will reveal to you what, up until now, has been running your life. You will hear how your patterns of thinking, feeling, and acting have been driving and directing your life. You will understand how to use the practice of Yoga Nidra to shape and create the life you want, rather than the one your past has created for you. This book is rich with yogic insight into the practical, everyday challenges we all face. After listening to it, you will have a better understanding of who you are, why you are here, and how to make the most of your human journey with the practice of Yoga Nidra. Section 1. Understanding the Ancient Secrets of Yoga Nidra. Chapter 1. Yoga Nidra, the Art of Transformational Sleep. What is Yoga Nidra? Yoga Nidra is a little-known ancient meditation technique. It works by taking you to brainwave states similar to those in sleep, where the biology of your body makes it easier to disengage from thoughts. Meditation happens when you are able to disengage from your thoughts and observe them rather than believe them. For many, however, seated meditation is challenging, and meditation becomes more about the effort of the technique and sitting still, and less about where the technique is supposed to take us to a state of relaxed, spacious awareness. Yoga Nidra is different. The technique itself is composed of a series of body, breath, and awareness techniques designed to effortlessly guide you into a state of complete non-doing. You are not practicing being aware so much as resting as awareness itself. You are resting in a space where thoughts spontaneously come and go without preference or pull toward any one thought. Here, even first-time meditators enter profound states of expanded awareness and deep relaxation. The secret to Yoga Nidra is that it consciously harnesses the biological function of sleep for a spiritual purpose. Every night, when we go to sleep, there is one thing we must do. We must be able to let go of our thoughts. If this does not happen, we will not fall asleep. This is insomnia. The process of sleep happens by dropping into progressively deeper brainwave states. As we enter these brainwave states, the mind slows down and our thoughts naturally begin to move further away from us until we fall asleep. In Yoga Nidra, we enter this process consciously. The techniques of Yoga Nidra enable the slowing down of our brainwaves and allow us to enter the twilight zone between us and our thoughts. In this zone, we gain entry to subtle realms where things that seem dense and difficult to change in the waking state become more fluid and easy to shift from the meditative sleep state. As we enter into more fluid states of consciousness, we can easily influence the visible and manifest from the invisible and unmanifest realm, the pure potentiality from which the visible arises. Making shifts in the waking state is akin to changing the shape of a block of ice. The body, thoughts, and all that is visible have already taken a concrete and densified shape. The hammer and chisel of will, discipline, and effort are needed here. Making shifts in Yoga Nidra is like making changes to water, which quickly and easily assumes the form and direction it is given. This unique element of Yoga Nidra is called sankalpa, or intention. The use of intention while in meditation is unique to Yoga Nidra. It is a way to specifically target and shift destructive patterns that compromise our health and well-being. History of Yoga Nidra. The practice of Yoga Nidra is as ancient as the practice of yoga itself. The first mention of the purpose of Yoga Nidra is in the Upanishads, which outline the nature of the universe and self-realization. There are 11 principal Upanishads. The Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, one of the oldest, is estimated to have been composed about 700 BCE, excluding some parts which may have been composed later. That is almost 1,000 years before the birth of Jesus. Though ancient Greek philosophy was eventually shadowed by the Dark Ages of Europe, such was not the case in the East. The enormity of accumulated wisdom in the Upanishads and other texts has continuously thrived for thousands of years and remains infinitely relevant today. The Upanishads sought to answer the question, "What is the single truth that, if known, would solve everything?" This question is the key to solving the riddle of human suffering. The Brihadaranyaka Upanishad includes this verse, Asatoma Prayer. Asatoma Sadgamaya Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya Mrityurma Amritam Gamaya. Brihadaran Rayaku Upanishad, Chapter 1, Section 3, Verse 28. Lead me from the unreal to the real. Lead me from darkness to light. Lead me from time-bound consciousness, death, to the timeless state of being, immortality, that I am. As you will come to understand, this verse outlines the ultimate spiritual purpose of both yoga and yoga nidra. You will understand this prayer is a truth, which, if known, could solve everything. Yoga nidra is a means to do just that. The Chandogya Upanishad, composed around the same time as the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, first discusses the four states of consciousness as awake, dream-filled sleep, deep sleep, and beyond deep sleep. Later, the Mandukya Upanishad, estimated to have been written in the first or second centuries after the birth of Jesus, describes the four states of consciousness through the sacred syllable, Om. The sound A relates to the waking state of consciousness, U to the dream state, and M to the deep sleep state. The silence that follows represents Turiya, the state of silent awareness within which all other states of consciousness arise. The purpose of Yoga Nidra is to realize and rest in this Turiya state. However, although the concept of Turiya existed, the practice of Yoga Nidra had not yet been born. Yoga Nidra was first born as a meditation practice around 500 to 600 CE, making it over 1,000 years old. This is around the time when the esoteric teachings of spirit were brought to the common man. Before then, it was considered holy to renounce all forms that were regarded as mundane, including the body, emotions, sex, money, and householder life. These were seen as obstacles to recognizing one's true nature. Then, a new and controversial stream of thought was born. Seekers realized that manifest existence is not separate from consciousness. Rather, it is the visible extension of consciousness. Instead of rejecting forms of human existence, such as the body and mind, these forms could serve as vehicles through which the formless could be realized. This stream of thought was known as Tantra. Today, Tantra has come to be associated primarily with sexual practices, but this perspective is very limited. In reality, any practice that uses the body-mind complex as a vehicle to become self-realized is a tantric practice. This shift in perspective birthed unprecedented access to higher consciousness for the common person occupied with the practicalities of daily subsistence. It opened the door to many new techniques and practices, including asana, yoga poses, mantra, chanting of sacred syllables, mudra, hand gestures which open up energy channels, and yantras, visualization of geometric forms. Yoga Nidra is one of these practices, born as a means to guide a practitioner from the three states in which the body exists, waking, dreaming, and deep sleep, into Turiya, awareness of existence beyond the body. The Mahanirvana Tantra, written in the 17th century, describes the technique of nyasa, placing attention and visualization combined with seed sounds on various energy points in the body. This is the basis of the 61-point Yoga Nidra technique that is still used hundreds of years later. Chapter 2. Yoga Nidra, the secret door to freedom, the first tool of Yoga Nidra, realization. Yoga Nidra allows us to kinesthetically experience the self beyond body and mind. Here, we simply rest as the space through which all experiences come and go. The more we rest as who we are, the less we are at the effect of what is passing through. We can be at peace and steady in the midst of external and internal disturbance. Yoga Nidra consists of a set of tools. If we know the purpose of the tools we are using and what we're trying to build with them, we are much more likely to arrive at the desired result. For example, a hammer is a tool, but that tool can be used in many ways, some helpful and some not so helpful. However, if we know the purpose of the tool, to build a house, for example, we already have some big clues that tell us how to use the tool. It will be obvious that the tool is not to be used to hit other people, but to hit nails. For this reason, it is essential not only to understand the six tools of Yoga Nidra, but also to understand what we are trying to build with those tools. Having a clear picture of the end result shows us how to utilize the tools in the way they were meant to be used. It also helps us to know when we have gotten off track and are no longer using the tools in a helpful way. For instance, yoga poses are a tool. Yet, what are they designed to achieve? A better body? A yoga butt? Or is there more to this 4,000 years old practice? Knowing what you're trying to build with the tool of yoga poses informs how you approach the poses and what you will get from them. If you know the pose is designed to help you manage not only the body, but also create equanimity in the mind, you will know when you are not practicing in a way that moves you toward the purpose of yoga. You will see that comparison, criticism, or excessive body image focus is actually taking you away from the original intent of the poses. However, if you do not know what the original intent is, you are less likely to arrive at the desired destination and will be unable to course correct as needed. When you judge yourself in a yoga pose, that judgment is counter to yoga's purpose. You could actually be practicing conflict on a yoga mat versus equanimity. In fact, not practicing yoga at all. This is why it is critical not only to understand the tools of Yoga Nidra, but for what purpose they are intended. Without this understanding, the potential underutilization of Yoga Nidra is great. For many years, Yoga Nidra has been sidelined as a guided relaxation, a spiritual name for a nap. This is because people don't understand what it is really intended to accomplish. Yoga Nidra is so much more than a guided relaxation or a nap. It is a secret door to liberation. Without this knowledge, however, one of the most profound practices of yoga can easily be overlooked in the ego's quest for something more exciting. Using Yoga Nidra as a nap is like using a jet plane to drive to the grocery store. You can do it, but it is a gross underutilization of its potential. A jet plane can drive, but it is meant to make you fly. Yoga Nidra can help you rest, but it was meant to help you soar. It was meant to liberate you from the suffering that afflicts human existence. In this chapter, we will explore the purpose of Yoga Nidra. Once we know what we're trying to build with its tools, the likelihood is great that we will be able to harness the practice to its fullest potential. The nature of the self. The self has several qualities. It is timeless, eternal, and unchanging. It is that which is present before, during, and after objects, both subtle and gross, come and go. It is the eternal backdrop of existence, and it sees. It is the witness of all that is passing through it. Self as witness. Imagine that you are sitting on top of a hill, surrounded by golden grassed hills on all sides. Down below, you see a road. The road is empty. Far off in the distance, to the right of your vision, you see a car come into your vision, into the center of your vision, and then off into the horizon. The car disappears from view. Can you see that if you are the one seeing the car, it cannot be you? You were there before the car. You were there while the car was there, and you were there after the car was gone. You were the one watching the car come and go. This is the nature of the eternal self. It is always there. It is there before things come, while things are there, and after they are gone. The eternal self is you, the one who is seeing things come and go. That is why it is called the witness. Let's develop this idea further. Imagine yourself at the age of 7. Your body size, your personality, how you were, what you looked like. Now, fast forward to a teenager. How were you then? What was your personality like? Now, fast forward to the present time. Notice your current body. Maybe the wrinkles on your face. Your personality? Notice that sometimes you look in the mirror and see your body change. Maybe you even ask yourself, is that me? We said, if you can see the car, it can't be you. What about the body? Can you see the body? Can you see it change? Are you there before the body changes? While it is changing? After it has changed? Consider that if you can see the body change, it can't be you. You are the one watching the body change. In fact, you are watching the body change in the same way you watch other bodies change. Some days the body is seen with bags under the eyes, other days not. Some days the body is observed with more weight or less weight. Over time, we see the body accumulate more wrinkles and more gray hair. There has to be an identifier observing these changes. That means the body cannot be the totality of you. There has to be something greater than the body that is aware of it. We could call it consciousness. That consciousness is a consistent, eternal thread that watches and observes all things in flux. Consciousness itself is unchanging, but serves as the background behind every changing experience. Self as background. Everything that comes, goes. Everything seen, heard, tasted, smelled, felt, or thought lives for a time, then dies. Yet, aren't you there before all these things arrive? While they are there? When they leave? Awareness identifies the presence and absence of everything. You are the one who sees it all come and go, because you are there to identify it. You are the one identifying an emotion when it is not present, when it is present, and when it is gone. You can say, I wasn't sad, then I was sad, and now I'm not sad anymore. Just like the witness watching the car, you are there to identify changing states. If you are the one identifying various gross and subtle objects coming and going, you have to be the unchanging constant within which these objects are coming and going. They cannot be you. You are not the one who is sad. You are the one who is there before, during, and after sadness comes and goes. See the difference? This small change in perspective has enormous significance, as you will hear. Now, what if we were trying to remove everything seen, heard, tasted, felt, and imagined? Everything. What is left? Nothing, right? No thing? This is how Zen defines the self. No thing. This is why, in many traditions, it is said that God should not be named or given a form. It is the formless itself. To give it a name is to try to capture something in form that is beyond form itself. The formless aspect of the self has no quality of its own other than its capacity for things to appear in it. It can be understood as space, background, formless capacity for what is. There can be no sound without the backdrop of silence within which the sound arises. Stars only appear in contrast to the background of the night sky. It is only in reference to formless that forms appear. Just as it is only in reference to silence that sound appears. We are not accustomed to paying attention to the space. We are accustomed to focusing on contents. When a thought moves through the mind, we don't pay attention to the silence behind it. We pay attention to the thought itself. The formless aspect of the self is where the concept of zero was first born in the East. It is only in reference to nothing that we can have the something of numbers. All numbers only appear in reference to nothingness. The concept of zero was at its origin a spiritual one. Even though it was the place from which mathematics were born, mystics would say zero is not something to be known or thought about, but to be experienced. That is exactly where Yoga Nidra takes us, to the experience of zero. That is why my father, Yogi Amrit Desai, the founder of the integrative Amrit method of Yoga Nidra, says, Yoga Nidra takes you to the zero stress zone. Self as unconditional love. The zero background is like a sky of awareness. A sky is simply perfect capacity for whatever is moving through it. It is totally allowing of whatever comes and goes through its space. The sky, by its nature, has no preference for clouds over lighting, birds over plains, or sun over rain. The sky's nature is to be unconditional capacity for everything to be as it is. Nothing is carved out, separated, or labeled as good or bad. The sky does not cleave what it likes from what it doesn't like. That is its nature. From the perspective of the sky-like self, things simply are. The self doesn't try to be unconditional. It is unconditional. Another word for this sky-like spacious allowing is love. Not emotional love, but pure, total, and unconditional acceptance. I am always struck by those who have near-death experiences and come back to report profound experiences of love. The message they return with is that we are wholly, fully, and profoundly loved by existence itself in a way we could never imagine. This love is always present, and there is nothing we can do to cause that love to disappear. It is the eternal and unchanging backdrop in which all manifest existence is unfolding. It is said that if we only knew how much we are loved, unconditionally received, we would not suffer the way we do on the human plane of existence. The nature of the self, then, is not nothingness, but is love itself. Everything that has ever taken place, every emotion, every thought, and every experience has happened in a backdrop of complete, total, and unconditional love. Complete, unconditional allowing and acceptance. Imagine a practice that restored our knowledge of this invisible backdrop to accompany our human existence. That is the potential of Yoga Nidra. Confusing the container and the contents. The background, zero quality of self, renders it very easy not to notice. It is like air. We don't walk around commenting on air or space, even though it is around all the time. We tend to notice the things in the space. When someone is speaking or the radio is on, we don't listen to the silence, we listen to the sound. We listen to that which is filling the space, rather than the space itself. Nor do we notice that acceptance is the quality of the space that surrounds all our experiences. This, according to yoga, is where we get caught. I will share an imperfect metaphor with you, but a useful one nonetheless. Imagine a lobster pot, a huge pot. In truth, the pot of awareness has no limits, edges, or boundaries, but for now, imagine a pot. The pot, like the sky, is perfect capacity for anything that is put into it. If you put potatoes into the pot is perfectly allowing of the potatoes. No preference, completely unconditional. When the potatoes are removed, there is no stain of the potatoes left. The pot is simply total capacity for the next thing, maybe carrots. When carrots fill the container, the pot is total capacity for them. A frame takes on the qualities of whatever it is framing, but it is perfectly unaffected by what it is framing. In the same way, the container perfectly receives and reflects the qualities of what is in it. If it contains potatoes, the container appears to take on the qualities of potatoes. It is potatoed. When carrots move through, the container appears to take on the qualities of carrots. It is carroted. Similarly, sadness and anger are passing experiences which are perfectly contained and allowed. When contained, the container appears to take on those same qualities, When those qualities are present, they are fully felt and received. And when they are gone, the container is left unstained and ready to receive the next experience. When emotion fills the container, it is fully felt and allowed to be. There is no resistance or fear of what is in the pot, no story about it. It is simply an experience that is present. When the experience comes, it is allowed to come. When it goes, it is allowed to go. So, what is the problem, you might ask? Since the container as a background presence doesn't announce itself, we tend to forget its presence and instead notice the contents. Let's say you are cooking spaghetti in a pot. If you lift up the lid, you are not very likely to say, "Nice pot with spaghetti in it." You are more likely to say, "Oh, spaghetti." In other words, we tend to notice the contents rather than the container itself. When we lose awareness of our containerness, the pot, we are subject to become identified with contents. Our perspective changes. Instead of recognizing we are the space through which sadness, anger, and various constellations of experiences are moving, it can appear that we are the contents. Just as we only see and experience spaghetti, we only see and experience the sadness, worry, or frustration. In forgetfulness of the background, there doesn't appear to be anything greater than the contents. It looks as if that is the totality of who we are. That is me. We don't say, "Sadness is moving through the space of awareness that I am." We say, "I am sad." We have become it. And because we believe ourselves to be it, we are bound by it. We no longer experience the sky-like self which is present before, during, and after all experiences come and go. We have lost remembrance of the ground of being, the zero space, the experiences with which we are identified, including the experience of our bodies and minds, become the limit of our existence. The limitless, eternal, unchanging, and unconditionally allowing source becomes limited and locked into identification with the worry, fear, and anxiety moving through it. These changing experiences, which constantly gather and dissolve in an unchanging flux, appear to have become us. And, bound by this illusion, we suffer. This confusion between the container and that which is contained is the source of suffering. It is the problem all yoga practices, including Yoga Nidra, seek to solve. In the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali, chapter 2, verse 17, it is said, "The union between the seer and the seen is the source of suffering." The body-mind is more consistently in the container than anything else. It is present from the moment we wake up until the time we go to sleep at night. Like the spaghetti, every time we look into the container, the body is there. It continues to be in the pot for 80 years or so. It moves like that car through awareness, but very slowly. We see the body grow, we see it flourish, and we see it get old. In truth, we are watching the body-mind just as we watched the car. Unlike the car, the body-mind is rarely ever not there, so it is no wonder we come to identify with the body-mind as the totality of what we are. In fact, One of the few times that the body is not in awareness is when we sleep. This is why Yoga Nidra is such a powerful opportunity. When we enter these sleep-like states consciously, we can experience the container that exists beyond the body. To clarify one point, yoga does not say you are not your emotions or the body, but rather that these are impermanent aspects of the self. They will come and go. An emotion, like a wave on an ocean, will live for a while, will move through the ocean, and then dissolve back into the ocean from which it came. The same is true of the body. It will live for a time, move through the container of consciousness, and will die, dissolving back into the consciousness from which it came. Consciousness itself remains eternal. Once this knowing is established, you will not be subject to the roller coaster of experiences in the same way you are now. Instead of feeling overwhelmed by the waves of thoughts, emotions, and experiences that overcome you, you will have a stable and dependable context of stillness and peace within which to experience it all. The contents of life do not disappear, but the perspective from which they are experienced changes. You know you can always touch the peaceful stillness that is your eternal nature, no matter what is moving through. This knowing radically changes your experience of life. Without this knowing, your happiness is dependent on the contents of the container. You can only be happy when the contents are desirable. Therefore, you have to manage the contents so you can feel happy for a time. With the experiential knowing of your true nature, your peace is always available, regardless of the contents. This is why many people report that even though nothing about their lives has changed, they simply feel happier and more content as a result of Yoga Nidra practice. The practice is establishing them in the self, where peace is accessible beyond reliance on circumstances. Remember the Asatoma prayer, first mentioned in the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad? It outlined the core question, what is the single truth that, if known, would solve everything? Listen to it again, based on what you just learned. Lead me from the unreal to the real. Lead me from darkness to light. Lead me from time-bound consciousness, death, to the timeless state of being, immortality. This is what the prayer is saying. If you can know the timeless being that you are, you will move from the darkness that comes from falsely assumed limitations to the truth of the eternal self. From this place of peace, you can allow all experiences to move through just as clouds move through a clear blue sky. Yoga Nidra is a tool designed to free us from these assumed limitations and restore our experiential knowledge of the eternal self. In other words, Yoga Nidra is a tool for realization of our true nature. How does Yoga Nidra solve the problem of misidentification? The mechanism by which Yoga Nidra seeks to solve this problem is simple. If you quiet or remove the contents of the container, it is easier to notice the container itself. This is what is written in Patanjali's Yoga Sutras, the first written codification of classical yoga. Chapter 1, verse 2. Yoga is the stilling of modifications of mind. Chapter 1, verse 3, then the seer abides in his own true nature. Imagine a sky background filled with birds, helicopters, planes, bees, and clouds. In that state, are you more likely to notice the stuff in the sky or the sky itself? The stuff, right? Yoga's solution is based on the same principle. The more mind stuff that fills our internal sky of awareness, the more difficult it is to notice our sky-like nature. The quieter it becomes, the less drama, the less weather patterns of the mind, the easier it is to notice what is behind it all. This is what is meant when Patanjali says, "Yoga is the stilling of modifications of mind. Then the seer abides in his own true nature." By removing the clutter that fills the sky of awareness, the sky itself is revealed. Yoga Nidra is stilling the fluctuations of mind and abiding as one's true nature through conscious entry into the sleep state. Yoga Nidra decreases mental modifications by decreasing the activity of the mind, that with which we are normally identified. As Yoga Nidra takes you toward the conscious sleep state, the electrical activity of the brain slows down, and the mind becomes less and less active in order to allow sleep. At some point, the activity of the brain waves slows down so much that we experience a gap of nothingness. No thoughts, no things fill awareness. Here, the only thing left to notice is awareness, the sky-like nature of self. Imagine that the mind stuff of our lives is like a movie projected on the screen of awareness. The screen is blank capacity. If the movie is very engaging, with lots of drama, many things happening, lots of ups and downs, we become so involved in the story that it is very hard to notice the screen on which that story is being projected. But the quieter, more calm and peaceful the movie becomes, the more likely we are to notice the screen on which the movie is projected. By calming the movie content of our lives, by becoming internally more still, more calm, and more peaceful, we quiet our movies. The more we can do this, the more likely we are to notice the screen itself, our true nature. Each time we enter Yoga Nidra, we shift our perspective. The movie is temporarily calmed or even stopped. In the deepest states, the only thing left is the screen itself. Here, we come to identify with and rest as the screen more and more. The more we rest as the screen, the less we are affected by what is projected onto it. We can simply allow the screen, our true nature, to be. Each time we emerge from Yoga Nidra and the movie of our lives begins again, we are less engaged by the drama. In other words, the more we begin to rest back as capacity, the less we are affected and dragged around by the contents. This is what realization is. Noticing and resting as the container that you are, rather than identifying with the contents. You are liberated from believing the mind stuff to be the totality of who you are. It is not that the contents change. In fact, the same things may be moving through your awareness, but the point of view has changed. You have restored your true perspective as the container itself. Yoga Nidra, in effect, takes you to a mini enlightenment state. Each time you go there, the longer you can stay there, and the more this temporary state becomes a permanent perspective. This brilliant yogic strategy is the foundation from which our expansive and formless source can be realized. Although not everyone is necessarily interested in self-realization, most people are interested in more happiness, more contentment, and more peace in their lives. Yoga Nidra provides these benefits of greater peace and inner calm in the midst of life, regardless of a person's interest in recognition of self. Yoga Nidra quiets inner noise. This makes the practice ideally accessible for those simply seeking greater relaxation and inner tranquility. Chapter 3. The Descent into Identification. Think of an ocean and its waves. The depths of an ocean are undifferentiated and have no form. Out of the depths of the ocean, waves arise. These waves come into individuated forms, as the body and mind do. But the waves are not separate from the ocean. They are the manifest aspect of existence. The only difference between the manifest, the wave, and the unmanifest, the ocean, is that the wave will eventually dissolve back into the ocean. It is impermanent. The ocean itself, however, remains the same. The body and mind are the visible, manifest, and embodied aspects of Source, arising from the unmanifest or formless aspect of Source. The manifest aspect of Source is finite. The body-mind will live and die. It is impermanent and exists in time between birth and death. The unmanifest aspect of existence is timeless, eternal, and unchanging. When we become solely identified with one aspect of our existence, we become exclusively attached to the mind and body and live in forgetfulness of the eternal aspect of our nature. We become solely identified with the wave as the totality of who we are and overlook the ocean from which we have come. This forgetfulness causes us to lose our connection to Source and the inner peace and stability that come from it. The kleshas, afflictions or obstacles, as outlined in the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali, map out the process by which we have forgotten the formless aspect of our true nature and have become exclusively identified with the mind-body as the totality of me. This limited view leads us into bondage and ultimately suffering. The kleshas explain the descent into identification with contents and the resulting consequences. Through greater understanding of how the problem was created, we can understand how the tools of Yoga Nidra are designed to undo it. If we can understand how a knot was tied, we can also understand how to untie it. Avidya, ignorance, forgetfulness. Have you heard the saying, "We are spiritual beings having a human experience"? Who we are is unconditional, eternal consciousness manifesting through the human experience. We are the ocean manifesting as a wave. The body is an instrument of this consciousness. The eyes, ears, senses, and thoughts of the body are the mediums through which consciousness interacts with the world of form. We might compare it to stepping into a character of a play. Consciousness gets to play the range of human experience via the body. When the character is joyful, it gets to experience joy. When the character is heartbroken, it gets to experience heartbreak. All the dramas of the human experience, from childbirth to marriage to divorce, achievement and loss, are fully experienced, fully allowed, and fully lived. Yet, consciousness knows those experiences are not its totality. Rather, these experiences are like waves moving through consciousness. As such, it is all allowed, all lived, all fully experienced. There is nothing to resist. It is all part of God's play. And, like the keys on a piano, you allow and even enjoy every note life has to offer. What happens, though, if you forget you are consciousness expressing itself through a character? What if you forget your true nature and believe you are the character? I imagine it as literally playing a role on a stage. Above that stage, the roof is open, and you are connected to consciousness experiencing the human experience. You know you are the sky of awareness, even though you are playing this role on the stage. But what if you forgot the sky of consciousness? What if you were only left with the body and the senses? It is as if the roof above you were to close up. There would be no connection to anything outside the box of human experience. You might feel cut off, alone, and the victim of the human condition with no connection or knowledge of anything outside this finite stage. The stage would become the totality and limitation of your existence. Now, imagine how it feels to forget you're playing a role. You become the role. It appears to be the totality of who you are. If the mind and body feel good, you feel good. If the mind and body feel bad, you feel bad. Experience that could once be enjoyed as part of the play of embodied existence, within a silent backdrop of the sky of awareness, becomes a deluge of events, feelings, and reactions that threaten to overtake you at any moment, if not managed with all your might. You suffer through it all, thinking it is all you, that there is nothing more. The experiences of life no longer feel like something to be fully allowed. They may feel like something to be feared, because there is no greater context of peace within which to experience them. From this limited perspective, it no longer feels as if you are a spiritual being having a human experience. It feels like you are not that which is there before, during, and after the experience. You are the experience. Once the stage becomes the limit of your universe, you may feel something is not quite right. Of course, something isn't right. You've forgotten the totality of who you are, but you don't know that. You are left with a nagging sensation, telling you that you need more of something or less of something else. It is like that feeling that you have when you go on a trip. You know you have forgotten something, but you don't know what it is. It leaves a lingering sense of unease, which needs to be taken care of somehow. It is a feeling of not being okay. Something's wrong. Sometimes we interpret something is wrong out there. Sometimes we interpret something is wrong in here, with me. No matter the interpretation, the feeling comes from the same place, a primal disconnection from source. Forgetfulness of one's true nature is called avidya. Vidya means knowledge. Avidya means lack of knowledge or ignorance. It is the fundamental mistake from which all others follow. We mistake the mind and emotions to be the totality of who we are. We take ourselves to be something we are not. This is the original error, and the one Yoga Nidra solves. In Christianity, it is called sin. The literal meaning of sin is missing the mark. This is where we miss the mark and suffer as a result. It is the original sin or originating error. However, from the yogic point of view, this is not a permanent state, and it can be solved. Yoga Nidra re-establishes a knowing of our true nature as that which is there before, during, and after experiences come and go. Here, we can allow for the full range of human experience to be held in a container of wholeness and allowing, just as a sky effortlessly holds all that is within it. Without this container, we feel lost in a world of contents, but with an essential knowing of self as the container of all, we can effortlessly rest in the place through which all contents pass. We can remain steady and centered, established beyond the flux. This is Yoga Nidra. Asmita, egoism. The body-mind is born in this world. Like a character in a play, it has a backstory. The body-mind was brought up in a particular family with certain cultural and social norms and beliefs. This character has certain experiences, both joyful and painful, that have formed how the body-mind thinks, acts, and behaves today. We could call these various influences programming. They are the past experiences, learning, and socialization that cause people to behave the way they do. This programming is not wrong or bad. In fact, it is necessary for the life of the body-mind complex. All the things we have learned since childhood have ideally been to help us survive and thrive in the environment in which we have been placed. Our programming teaches us to discriminate when to cross the street and when not to. It tells us how to hold a knife so we don't get cut, and what is safe to eat and drink. Programming also teaches us subtler things, like how to act within social norms, how to get and keep a job, and how to be a law-abiding, productive member of society. It also largely determines what we think, how we think, what our opinions are, and what our worldview is. The body-mind is essentially programmed in much the same way a computer is programmed. It acts in accordance with what has been fed into it, either in this lifetime or other lifetimes. This backstory of the character in the play is what we commonly call the ego. It is the constellation of accumulated thoughts, beliefs, and experiences we have come to call me. As you can see, there's nothing wrong with the ego or the programming it carries. It is wholly necessary for functioning on this plane. We do not want to get rid of it. So, where does the problem arise? When you believe yourself to be this, and only this. You identify with the mind-made programmed sense of self as me. When identified with the character and its backstory as you, you become it, and it becomes the limit of your world. The eternal self, though still present, is forgotten. In its place, you call all of your experiences, feelings, thoughts, and opinions me. This is called asmita or egoness. Raga and vesha, attraction and aversion. Once we lose touch with our eternal self, we feel barraged by the unending waves of external experiences and internal reactions ceaselessly assaulting us. There is no rest, there is no peace here, because by nature, things will always be moving through the container. Lived from the wave perspective, there seems to be no end, no way to get away from the onslaught of life except for short periods of time. We have no backdrop of wholeness from which to experience it all. Now, it appears the only way to quench that sense of unease is to do something, make things happen, find wholeness through the people, places, and things on the stage. We can no longer let life happen as we did before, when we knew ourselves as the ocean manifesting as a wave, enjoying the play of human experience. Life becomes something to be managed, controlled, and steered to quell that inner sense of unease, to give us a measure of peace and stability. The ease that came from knowing Source in the midst of changing experiences is lost. In its place, we come to rely on resources rather than Source to give us the sense of wholeness we are missing. In my experience, everyone the world over has this feeling. We all have the feeling we are missing something, that things are not quite okay. We feel overwhelmed or isolated. We are all yearning for a sense of peace, a time when all that noise inside will be quiet and we can deeply rest. Every person and every culture has a different way of attending to it, through relationships, money, success, or recognition. While the eternal self is simply the background that allows things to come and go, we, as the character, cannot allow things to come and go because they are us. The container is space for it all to be, but if we forget that container, our happiness depends on the contents. The contents are no longer something to be allowed. They are something we have to manage. It feels as if the only way we can be happy is to make sure there are happy contents in the container. Pain and loss are the last things we want in the container. As a result, we no longer fully embrace and allow certain parts of the human experience. In fact, we do our best to avoid them. If our whole life is made up of notes like that of a piano, we become afraid of certain notes. The only way to be whole, or to at least be okay for a little while, is by managing the types of notes that are moving through our lives. Rather than wanting to experience the whole of life and all the notes it has to offer, the only way it seems we can manage to feel okay is to keep away the painful, bad notes and try to get some good ones. We end up playing traffic cop with life, trying to hold on to certain experiences and allow them through, while we try to hold others at bay. We become attached to what we like and want in the container, and are afraid of what we don't like and don't want in the container. All because we have come to believe that the contents determine our happiness. Experience becomes less about its inherent and intrinsic satisfaction. Experience becomes a means to manage the original discomfort we feel in life. Food is not just about food. Sex is not just about sex. Work is not just about work. They become a means to feel good and avoid feeling bad. Sex, relationships, money, cars, houses, jobs, promotions, and recognition become instruments to keep the pain of separation at bay. It is as if, in our separation from self, we go to the ego and ask it, "How can I feel whole? How can I feel happy?" Unfortunately, the mind can only tell us to be happy based on the knowledge or experience it has acquired in the past. The mind biologically operates on a binary survival system, pleasure and pain. Therefore, it is only capable of telling you how to be whole in the same way it keeps the body whole, reproducing pleasure and avoiding pain. There are four basic strategies for happiness that the mind can give you. 1. It can tell you what made you happy in the past and to reproduce it. 2. It can tell you what made you unhappy and to avoid it. 3. It can tell you what you felt you lacked in your past and to make up for it. 4. It can tell you what society tells you will make you happy and to go acquire those things. If you look at whatever your mind tells you will make you happy, you will be able to trace it back to one or several of these things. The mind is a closed system. It cannot open us up to anything more than what has been put into it. That doesn't make the mind bad. It means the mind is limited in its capacity to give us the answer we are seeking. When we live from the mind, the happiness we seek cannot be more than a refashioned version of our past. If we follow the mind's solution, our whole life will revolve around keeping painful situations at bay rather than living life. We will do whatever it takes not to experience the pain of rejection, heartbreak, abandonment, and failure. And we invest our time in the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.